Like somebody's recording this morning.
Oh, I mean, I hit the start button anyway.
I thought Brother Mike said he's the only one that's supposed to get recorded.
Pastor's orders.
So it's really comfortable in this room here, but at the same time, this is where we have the sermon and everything, so I think people like more formal, and I gotta not move and can't sneeze and stuff and whatever, but please feel free to participate. I mean, that works so much better. And my wife's like, just remember, nobody wants you to talk the whole time and listen to all your boring stuff. So I guess that's what wives do for you, right? They tell you, yeah, you can always do better. So, but yeah, she's exactly right. So Sunday school, I definitely hope that you will participate and say what you think. Exodus is one of my favorite things ever. So we didn't have like these blockbuster movies as much when I was a little kid. But the Ten Commandments, that was pretty much a blockbuster movie. And so this is a long time before Star Wars ever thought about coming around. And it's one of the movies that my family was, all right, you gotta sit down and watch this movie. I'm like, okay, what is this? So you know, didn't know anything about it. And we did watch it, and it wasn't done by religious people, so there's a lot of stuff in it's incorrect. But the gist of it is correct. And I guess I'm grateful that my first introduction to it was something that I thought was, wow, this is unbelievable, this actually happened. And then, of course, from studying it, you realize how even more great it was and how much of a blessing it was and how much importance it was to all of us as Christians and all of us as far as God's plan and how it unfolded in the Bible and just one of the big, huge pieces of that story. And so it's great for us today studying Exodus. So when I saw Exodus, I was really, really excited about it. And Moses wasn't like the Harvard graduate, I'm here, I'm in charge, I'm going to take care of everything, I know it all, and you're not as smart as me, so shut up and get in line, all that stuff. That was not the kind of leader that Moses was. I really admire the way that God led him and how he followed the Lord. And I think the example that Moses, how he dedicated his life to the Lord and to service is such a great example. So, great one for us to follow. So Exodus comes after Genesis. I think most people know that. But the story of what family was in Egypt, I guess the one we left off. Anybody remember that? From, I guess, 6 months ago when we studied in January last year, I guess it was. Or this year. No, January this year.
Joseph's family.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jacob's family, actually.
Yeah.
Joseph. One in charge.
Yeah. Yep. So, and the reason they came to Egypt was because of the famine, right? So, they went to Egypt to survive. Turned out through God's provision that Joseph was in Egypt in a place of prominence working to basically plan for the famine and basically save the whole nation. And obviously that all happened, and then that family all moved to Egypt, and that's where they lived. So that was the lineage of Abraham, right? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which was going to become the nation of Israel later, which actually during this time we're going to be studying. So that's pretty exciting too. So what happened? Once they got to Egypt, they got through the famine, everything, right? But then what happened? it was pretty good, right?
Yeah.
They stayed there. It was, they had food, they had everything they needed, they had all the land they wanted, they were prosperous. They had many children, they grew, they were blessed. And these are all Abraham's children. And we know the promise that God made to Abraham is that his people would be so great, it would be greater than the number of the stars and the sands, not only on the beaches, the sands in the sea. So uncountable, basically. So that was the promise made. So they were very prosperous in Egypt, but then everything changed. And so that's just like us. We see things happen all the time. It could be your neighborhood, or it could be the place you work, or the school you go to, or whatever. Everything's fine. It could be your community. Everything's going great, and then now suddenly, seems like it's suddenly, but I guess it happens maybe not as suddenly as we think sometimes. Everything's different, and then it's time to do something. It's time to take action. It's time to do something different than what you have been doing. And so Exodus is really the story of how all the Hebrews that were in Egypt were going to be led not only out of Egypt, but led to create their own nation that was separate and in the Promised Land, which is even later. So it's not necessary that the Lord wants us to be comfortable all the time. I think the Lord wants us to be uncomfortable some of the time to help us to take action and do things to help further His work. And sometimes even I think, why am I feeling a burden on my heart to do this thing? And I don't really understand it. And then later on, I realize, okay, that was what God wanted me to do, and I didn't necessarily understand it at the time, but looking back, I could understand it a lot better. So, let's see. So the writers of the quarterly and the study that we have are different than the ones we had in the past. And they like to write little text. So the quarterlies, it's all little tiny text. Mark David Clements is a senior pastor at New Liberty Baptist Church in Garland, Texas. His picture is actually on page 2 in the quarterly. So I think it is important to know actually who's writing the material. He's from Texas Baptist Institute and Seminary. So that's the writer of the quarterly. And there's a couple of different other writers. For the teacher study guide, actually three of them, and their pictures are all in here, and I can show it to you if you want to see it. But one of these is Brother David Butamore Sr. from California, and he was a music director, vice president, president of ABA, and now he's the chairman of the Baptist Sunday School Committee for the ABA. And then we've got another one helping out, Larry Crouch from Bayshore Missionary Baptist Church in Vallejo. Sorry, he's not there now. He's actually been going to Washington, California, but he's like, looks like he's in the Fresno area. And then the last one is Mark Thornton, Malvern, Arkansas. It says here he was a Big Creek Missionary Baptist of Malvern. And then he's done different things, including studying Bible languages in Israel, which sounds pretty exciting. Brother Jim, do you know any of these people that I'm talking about?
Yeah, I went to school with Mark.
Down at Oxford?
No.
At Little Rock.
At Little Rock, okay. All right. So that's the writers of the teacher's literature. And I thought, they always have this thing on here, I should show you this time. So they have these things on here, little like side notes. It calls it manna. So we're going to be studying about manna. So that was interesting when I was studying it. Okay. So what, before we get into all the details, what is the whole story of Exodus? Anybody want to volunteer? By the way, everybody's welcome to say something, so might get volunteered sometimes.
What is it about? The story of the Israelites becoming from well-treated to into slaves instead, and their ability to trust in God to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians. And this tells how Moses came in representing God's word and pulled them out of Egypt into the desert before they come to the promised land.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's the whole story of the thing. Why is it so important? Yeah, we're going to study it many, many times in our studies that the Hebrews cried out for the Lord to help them through this whole situation.
In chapter 20, he begins giving the law, and they're in rebellion before Moses ever got off the mountain.
Yep.
But over and over, it would show they rebelled. But when they repented, God just said, let's go forward. Mm-hmm. I mean, it shows what a great God we have in that even though we mess up, as soon as we're willing to admit it, he's ready to go with us again.
That is such a great point. And when you look at Israel and all the stuff that happened, especially after they were led out of Egypt, I know sometimes I think, how could they be doing this? How could these people be so sinful? And then the same day, I'll do something like, how could I do that? Because we're the same as they are, right? That's the whole thing of it. Israel is God's chosen people, but we're the same as they are. We're human beings, they're human beings. We're sinners, they're sinners. It's all the same. And so God doesn't turn his back on us. We turn our back on God, but God doesn't turn his back on us. And so, you know, when we're ready, God can work with us. And in this case, with Moses, we're going to see what did God do to prepare Moses to do all the things that are in the book of Exodus. I mean, can you even imagine? I mean, there's no technology. It's all rocks and sticks and stuff back in those days. Can you imagine doing something as significant as this, where you just have primitive resources available to you to be able to do all this? And clearly God's hand was on him from the very beginning, on his parents, and on the situation, as he was with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob before him. So, let's see. So let's go ahead and get into it. As far as the verses go, let's see. Does somebody want to read that first chapter?
They all
So that was only 22 verses. There's a whole lot going on in 22 verses. The very first part of it, like we talked about, was Joseph's family. Joseph was in a position of great influence in Egypt, and then his brothers sold him into slavery, but it ended up that he was part of, actually, the, I guess you could say, the mastermind of the plan to save the whole country from the famine. And ultimately, at the end of Genesis, his whole family moved in. So in the first verses here, you see his whole family did move over there, and they were provided land. And of course, Joseph ultimately died, and then all of his family, his immediate family at that time, passed away. But all their children did extremely well there for hundreds of years after that. And so I got to look that up. I know I studied it earlier. It's like time. Genesis and the beginning of Exodus. 430 years. So that is a very long time to pass after that. And they stayed in that area the whole time. The whole family stayed there the whole entire time. And while they were there, they led a comfortable life, as we talked about. And pretty soon everybody forgot about what had happened there, what Joseph had done, and what their whole family had done. There was a new king who didn't really know anything about it or didn't care, one or the other. But then started feeling threatened because the Jews were greater in numbers than the Egyptians. So even though it was the Egyptians' land, there were more Jews than there were Egyptians. And so they were feeling threatened, and so they enslaved the Hebrews, and as we read here, talked about they made their lives bitter with hard bondage and mortar and brick and all manner of service in the field, wherein they made them serve was with rigor. And so any of the hard jobs, the difficult jobs, that's the jobs the Hebrews did. So they enslaved them and they made them do all the hard work. So at the same time, you could look at they were slaves in bondage, but I almost look at it in a completely different way. They were in boot camp. They were learning how to be strong, how to be tough, how to solve problems you got to solve every day. And we'll see a little bit more about the whole birthing thing in a second. But if you're Egyptian, you knew how to do stuff. If you're a Hebrew, you knew how to build stuff. You knew how to get the raw materials. You knew how to pull it all together. You had insights into all the hard things it takes to live. And this was just the start of their time in getting away from their time of comfort to getting into the time where they were becoming a lot stronger, a lot tougher. And as you see over this longer period of time, that pretty much continued on as we go through it. This king of Egypt at the time that spoke to the Hebrew midwives, you notice he didn't talk to anybody else. He just talked to the midwives. And so I'm wondering if what happened was almost try to do it as a subterfuge of, yeah, what's happening? It's a mysterious thing that all the men babies are dying or whatever. But he was the one that told them to do it, which was to kill the male sons. And I guess a lot of children can die in childbirth, but and if you're the midwife, then it can be confusing as to what happened, if you're the mother or parents or whatever. But the midwives, they didn't follow the direction of the king. Shiphrah and Puah did not follow the direction of the king. And when the king came back and said, hey, what's going on? Why are all these male children still alive? Then they said, well, the Hebrew women are lively. And I guess I'm taking that to mean that they didn't even ask for a midwife when they had a baby. They just said, we'll do it ourselves with our family and our friends or whatever. They were smart enough to know what was going on, and I think the midwives probably told them what was going on. So they had the baby before they got there. Or they got there and helped them, and then they just said that's what happened. And just didn't tell the truth about it. So either way,
one time I would think that maybe even if the midwife was there, saying if they were lively, if they delivered a baby boy, maybe they snatched it up and took off. You know, like some people would just languish there because they've been in pain. Maybe they just, if they realized it was a son, they got off with a baby. I don't know, but just I'm surmising.
Yeah, but the midwives,
they had a plan, right? But they didn't. It was their son killed.
But it's pretty clear here that the midwives didn't follow the orders, and so, which is punishable by death if you don't follow the king's commandment. So the fact that they disobeyed what the king said, and the king asked for an explanation, and they gave one, and they weren't killed, and that by itself was God's provision for them of following his will. And so, from the very beginning of this whole story, God's hand was in it, and God's hand was taking care of not just Moses, but these other babies as well.
I think God definitely protected them and blessed them, because you can see times where a king gives an order and it wasn't followed through, and then even if there is a rational explanation, the person involved is sentenced to death anyway. And I feel like God definitely protected them in that moment against Pharaoh, and I also really enjoyed getting to read about God blessing them with families later on too, because it just shows that when you fear God and when you follow him, like, he's going to bless you, and he's not just going to not remember what you did.
Mm-hmm. And the fact that they were mentioned by name, not every single person that follows the Lord's will is mentioned by name in the Bible, but these two are mentioned by name.
It's really not clear whether they were Egyptian or Hebrew,
right.
But either way, they had a moral obligation to God. They acknowledged a moral obligation to God.
I thought it did say Hebrew requires.
Just listen to the wives.
Oh,
okay. It is more than it was. I didn't read that.
I just think it's neat though how, like, they were just doing what they felt was right, and they were trying to follow God, and thousands of years later we're reading about them, and it, like you said, like it did mention their names, and they were obviously just they probably had no idea of, like, the impact they were making and how people would read about it later. They were just trying to do what was right.
Yeah. Same way we do. We don't realize our impact.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. When God leads us to do something, we don't know God's overall plan or even exactly what role we're playing in it. But if we're doing what God wants us to do, then his plan can happen, right? We're the arms and legs. So, yeah. And so their names are mentioned here, and then in this manna section, since you all know it's there now, Shifra means beauty and Pua means splendor. So never knew that either. But obviously these two women played a huge role in fulfilling God's promise to Abraham. People that Abraham never even heard of or knew about. So that was a true blessing. And what he was really asking them to do was to perform abortions on these male children. And then there's a side note in here, which I wasn't tuned into the actual numbers, but what it says in here about the midwives, they understood the sanctity of life from the beginning. They knew murder was wrong. But even today, infanticide is practiced in a number of countries despite the fact that it's illegal, or in some cases, unfortunately it is legal, but it says here 42 million abortions happen each year around the world, and 1.37 million in the United States alone, which is 3,700 per day. And the Bible teaches us, as we know, that life begins in the womb at conception, and there are several different examples in the Bible that talk about that, and they also, it also talks about how conception is a gift from God. And we know that in our own personal experience, that tall kid sitting next to Darla on the left would not be here if we were not blessed. We had difficulty, and it was several years of us working on it, and the Lord blessed us. And so, can't say how blessed we've been as a family because of our children. And so, the fact that people are killing so many babies every single day, it's overwhelming to think about. But it sure does seem to be something that we could do something about, obviously not just for our own personal lives, but the people we witness to and the people we talk to try to encourage them not to do it. And I know I was reading somewhere this last week that our president's trying to define when life begins. And so I don't want to get started on that whole thing. It's just very frustrating when people are trying to impose their will on you, the things they will say to try to do that, and things that are not factual at all. So enough said, I guess, on that. Pharaoh had an immense power, and the midwives had to know that, but they feared God more than they feared Pharaoh. So, what's this whole stool thing? Does anybody know about the stools? Talks about that in the next section we're going to read. About the birth stools.
I don't think they lay in bed. They birth on a, like a chair or a stool. Mm-hmm. So, while they were sitting up. Not, that's just my connotation of it.
Yeah. So, like two rocks that are separated that they use for that purpose. And they said the Egyptians, the background information, that they would treat it almost like a religious ceremony, that they had all kinds of, I'm guessing idols, but I don't know because they didn't say that. It said all kinds of writings and things like that related to it, and there was a ceremony associated with birth. And in all of these things, the Hebrews were not doing any kind of religious ceremony, anything like that. At least didn't mention it. But the birth stool are two stones that they normally use for that purpose. And so, I was there when all three of our kids were born, and even though I went to all those classes and everything, yeah, here's all the stuff, it was still pretty much a surprising thing. So, even all three of them are sort of different in different ways, but I would say that it was a blessing to be able to be there. It was a blessing that Darla got to do it, and I didn't. I was really happy about that part of it. But it was a huge, huge blessing in our life, just our own family, and for all of you too, I'm sure. But can you imagine not having that blessing and having a child murdered that they wouldn't be here? That's just unbelievable to imagine. Okay, so let's see.
So I was like reading that. So they did. They were killing the males. I guess they thought that they would be warring on them if they grew in number, but that the females then could go ahead and marry the Egyptians and be assimilated into the culture. That's why they didn't just
Yeah, I think so. I think that's what it was. So then in chapter 2, that's when we start learning about Moses specifically. Let's see. Somebody like to read the first 10 verses of chapter 2?
There went a man of the house of Levi and took to wife a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, and hid him 3 months. And when she could no longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes, and dabbed it with slime in a little pitch, and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flags by the river spring. And his sister stood afar off to wit what would be done to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the river's side. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child. And behold, the child wept, and she had compassion on him, and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." And then said his sister to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call to thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go," and the maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, "Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee thy wages." And the woman took the child and nursed it. And the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she called his name Moses. And she said, "Because I drew him out of the water."
So we read the first chapter of 22 verses, and there's a whole 400 years it happened. And now we're reading the first 10 verses of chapter 2, and then there's a lot of other things going on. This is a really huge thing. And I know some people I work with would say, "Well, if you look at this woman building this thing, she's like one of the first engineers." There's people that I work with that would say that. But she had a plan. This whole entire time, she had a plan on how she was going to do this, and no doubt the Lord was helping her prepare and do the parts that she did, but also to prepare the heart of Pharaoh's daughter was something that the Lord obviously did also. So this is the kind of thing I would never imagine something like this. It's just not think of something happening like this, but obviously it did. And I just think the ways that the Lord works. The Lord doesn't always go through the front door in an obvious way. And, you know, we think of David and other people in the Bible that pretty much burst the front door down and whatever. This was a very crafty plan. This was a well thought out plan. This is almost like a Mission Impossible movie, you know, where they got 15 things going on simultaneously and everything. This is extremely well coordinated and well managed and everything. And the Lord's blessings were upon it, which was the most important thing of all, is that the woman conceived and bare a son. And when she saw that he was a goodly child, she hid him for 3 months. I can't even think of the idea of hiding a baby for 3 months. I can't figure how somebody would do that. How would you hide a baby from people that would want it to be killed? And I don't know. I guess there's other stuff in here they figured out that was not shown. And then obviously she put the miniature ark to the bulrushes, and then the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself, and she saw it, and when she opened it, she saw that there was the Hebrew child in there. So I don't know how you could look at a baby and tell that they're a Hebrew baby, but I know in the movie, they put a Hebrew blanket in there, so that was a pretty good idea. I'm not sure that's what happened, but that's what they did to make it obvious. So they may have done something like that, or some other thing that identified the baby as Hebrew. And then his sister this is Moses' sister, said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call a nurse of the Hebrew women that she may nurse the child for thee? So that's those people that come up with good ideas. But if I go grab that person right over there, that's a nursing mother, they'll probably be a great person to take care of this baby you just found 5 minutes ago. And mother's got a big smile on her face. I don't know, who knows how it was exactly. And by the way, I hope we do know. Once everything happens and we're all with Jesus and all that, I hope that we understand these things better than we do. And that, that's going to be revealed to us. Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee wages. So now she's being paid to be Moses' mother, even though she is already Moses' mother. And it said he grew and he became her son. She called his name Moses because she drew him out of the water. So that pretty much gets you to 40 years, I think. And so you can imagine this him being a son, or treated as a son of Pharaoh's daughter, that he went to school with the Egyptians. He did all the stuff that Egyptians do. Got the benefits the Egyptians got, whatever. But then he decided that's not what he wanted. And so when you look at the next verses here, it shows how much of a heart that he had for the Hebrew people, which really separated himself completely from the Egyptians. He had to be thinking this the whole entire time, but and he had to know his mother with his mother too, I think. But at what point do you actually do something about it? I think you've thought about that a lot over the years. Who would like to read from verse 11 to verse 25?
And it came to pass in those days that Moses was grown, and he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens, and he spied the Egyptians fighting at his brethren, and he looked this way and that way, and when he saw that there was no man, he slew the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. And when he went out the second day, behold, two men of the Hebrews rose together, and he said to him that did the wrong, wherefore smitest thou thy fellow? And he said, who made thee a prince and a judge over us? And intendest thou to kill me as thou killest the Egyptian? And Moses feared and said, surely this thing is known. Now when Pharaoh heard this thing, he sought to slay Moses. But Moses fled from the face of Pharaoh and dwelt in the land of Midian. And he sat down by a well. Now the priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came and drew water and filled the troughs to water the father's flocks. And the shepherds came and drove them away. But Moses stood up and helped them to water their flock. And when they came to rule your father, he said, how is it that you are come so soon today? And they said, an Egyptian delivered us out of the hands of the shepherds, and also drew water enough for us to water the flocks. And he said unto his daughters, where is it? Why is it that you have left the man? Call it that he may eat bread. And Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah, his daughter, and she buried his son, and called his name Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a strange land. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage. And they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them.
Okay, a lot happened in that time too, in those verses. Next, Brother Homer. So in verse 11 here, it says that Moses was grown and he went unto his brethren, so he knew that the Hebrews were his brothers, and they knew the same. And he looked on their burdens, and he spied an Egyptian smiting a Hebrew, one of his brethren. And when nobody was looking, or he thought nobody was looking, he slew the Egyptian. And so he thought that the Hebrews are going to think, well, that's a good thing because I'm taking care of them. And that's not how they thought about it at all. They thought they were going to be next, is what it looked like happened after that. And so it seemed like the real lesson for Moses there was, our plan is not a good plan. I think he planned it for about, he probably had the feelings building up inside of him for a very long time, but he took action, and the action wasn't the way God wanted the whole situation to happen in Egypt. So Moses wasn't ready. He was ready to leave, but he wasn't ready to take over as the leader of the Hebrew people. And I guess he even said, I think in this other lesson book, is that he thought that he would be accepted by the Hebrews, but at that time he wasn't. And so he left with Pharaoh, knowing he had done it. So he was Pharaoh's daughter's son, and Pharaoh wanted him to be killed. And so he was on the run, or on the lam, whatever you want to say. And I don't believe that God put him in a random place. Sometimes when we're running from something, we think we're going to a random place. But God was looking out for him. You know, it was God's plan that he would go to Midian. And there he met up with Jethro and his daughters. And that's where he stayed for 40 years. And he had a family there. He married Zipporah. Actually, no, Zipporah is his daughter. Sorry.
No, you're right. Zipporah. Or was married.
He gave Moses Zipporah. Oh, I didn't underline enough. Thanks. Yeah, Zipporah was his wife. And then his son was Gershom, which you don't hear much about him in the rest of this, but he did have a family. And all this time that Moses is here, the situation in Egypt is getting worse and worse on his people. The people are still growing, the people are still getting more and more population, and more and more slavery, and harsher slavery. But at this time, this is where the Lord is preparing Moses to become the leader of the Hebrew people. So Moses' older sister, Miriam, she actually comes into the picture again later. But isn't it really interesting what her role was in this whole thing? It was very much orchestrated between his parents, Amram and Jochebed, and Miriam. And they all had a plan that saved Moses' life and put him on the path of being the leader of the human leader of the Exodus. We're only doing two chapters today, so I know Brother Mike sometimes said, like, do 10 chapters in the book of John or something, which is almost impossible to do, but this is really interesting how Moses was selected, that he had faithful parents and faithful family that put him on a track to ultimately be the person that God used. I also find it interesting in the studies, too, that we think of Moses is one of the most important people in our study of the Bible, but it's the same for other religions as well. For Jewish people, they look at Moses as one of the most important prophets from their religion, and other religions look at Moses as a significant figure. And you really don't hear people questioning the existence of Moses too much. That he ever existed or that this ever happened. They talked about going back into some of the archaeological evidence and the other evidence that it all happened. And as you were saying earlier, it was widely known everywhere that this happened, and the Lord was into it. The Lord was the one that led them out. The Hebrews were very strong, so much of it happened that there was just no question that it doesn't seem anybody questioned that this actually did take place. So, well, I think that's all for the lesson today.